Hill United Church of Christ. This morning I'm having a little problem because the Verkhaitans don't sit on this side. And here you are. We're here to celebrate Maryland in a big way. And I will say that this morning, many, many people have already been here and left as they've come to celebrate her, to remember her. A lot of laughter, a lot of hugs. That will continue as we go. A couple things. In the bulletin, it indicates that in the back of the church, there are angels and doves and birds, whatever, on a table as you exit. Please take one in remembrance of Marilyn, and they're beautiful, and I know she'd want you to have one, so please go ahead and take one of those for her. Second thing is there's a meal afterwards. Please make your way downstairs if you need help. Someone will help you to find your way. There is enough. And you want to come, and Marilyn would want you to come. And third, immediately as the service ends, we will be exiting here, whomever would like to go, out the back doors and just around the corner into the courtyard. Marilyn's urn, her remains are going to be interred in the columbarium in the courtyard. And please, you're invited to come out there, very brief. Probably don't even need a coat. Just come right on out. We'll be there. If you do not feel or you do not want to, please go ahead and go downstairs. And we will be there shortly. There's also a time of remembrance. I'll have the microphone and I'll come around to you if you'd like to say something. Please know that's a real important time in the service. It's very important that everyone hear what you have to say in remembrance of Marilyn. So if you have something, just raise your hand, or two, if you want to come up front and stand here. Again, we're so grateful that you're here. Let us open our service with a word of prayer. Gracious God, your goodness is new to us this morning. Your goodness as we come to remember your child, Marilyn. To remember the love that she shared, the voice she had, the dedication to you and to her church, and to so many causes. We are grateful for her life. And this morning we are grateful for each one who has come to share in this celebration, to share their story, and to be strength for this family, for the living of these days. So for what we hear, for what we sing, and for what we pray, we ask your blessing today. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 638. It's in the red hymnal that is right in front of you, 638.
Thank you.
the Gospel according to Mark. One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked Jesus, "Which commandment is the first of all?" And Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.'" This is the word of the Lord. We have special music today from
She was a woman known and beloved by many, and her strength and worldly wisdom served her and those she loved for all her days. Her giving heart often led her not only to accept, but to seek and embrace more responsibility than was ever hers to rightly bear, and with only ever a partial grumbling about it. Even as she neared her final days, she told me all that she had left to do, calls to make and budgets to approve, meals to prepare and appointments to keep, and words still left to say. She and I spent a great deal of time together over the last few years, as she often needed someone to take her to a menagerie of doctor's appointments, and she spoke to me at length about the extraordinary life that she had behind her, fondly recalling her many years with her brothers and sister, her many friends, and her family whom she cherished above all else. And she spoke often of her mother and the kind and gentle soul she possessed, and once said she regretted that I and her mother never had the opportunity to meet. Her favorite color was yellow, which I decided to wear today in her honor. It has always been a very special feeling, being wrapped in the warmth of a person departed, but who had such a massive and loving presence that it endured in the world long after she had passed. Now it seems that Marilyn has taken that role herself. The indignity of a sudden passing has left a great deal between us unsaid, but I believe that she and I came to understand each other more intimately than ever before as I entered adulthood. She told me many times that she was satisfied with all that she had accomplished, and that should her time come, she would be able to leave this world without regret. I can only hope that our loss of her has in turn finally freed her of the pain and exhaustion she so valiantly endured for so long, and that she may find joy among those who preceded her. So, to a woman of valor who met every challenge fearlessly, to a woman of queenly grace who wore a crown of love and dogmasness, to a woman of wisdom who spoke ever with care and curiosity, and to the woman to whom I compare all others, who for all my days shall reside in my heart. Go now with all my love until we meet again.
Good morning. I'm Kelly Miller. I was a very good friend of Marilyn's. She was my very good friend. I'd like to tell you about my dear friend, Marilyn McCrylin. We met back in 1979 in the council room. That's 43 years ago. She was a 7th and 8th grade Sunday school teacher. After talking with her, in the problem she was having with these wonderful kids, 7th and 8th graders, I decided to help her in her teaching of these kids. And there were about 20 of them at that time. Marilyn and I taught together for 15 years, and I really felt we were a great team. What I didn't think of she did, she didn't think of I did, we were just a smooth running team, and we loved our kids. We usually met at church during the week while our daughters, Terry and Melanie, attended junior choir practice. I gotta confess that I learned a lot about the Bible from Marilyn. She really knew her Bible and she really loved the New Testament. A couple of times, Marilyn and I were brave enough to keep our students overnight in the church. It's called a lock-in or lock-up or something like that. We all slept on the floor in the bedroom. We ate pizza, we played games, we watched movies, and had scavenger hunts. In the morning, we had breakfast before Sunday school, so they were having a lot of fun before they had to go to Sunday school. Marilyn was a great leader, many times working behind the scenes, getting all things done. She wore many hats, Sunday school teacher, council member, council chairman, I should say council chairwoman. She headed many committees, Board of Christian Education for one, and organized many activities like broad fries, rummage sales, the PPP at UCC, which, do you remember that? Well, the PPP at UCC was the post-Pentecost party, because Pastor Candler said, we should really get something and we should remind everyone about the Pentecost. And we came up with this, the PPP post-Pentecost party, and it was our last party before summer, before the end of Sunday school. And it was a great success. It was fun too. And then she also was a member of Dorcas. Actually, Dorcas Ministry Group started as Circle Four, yes. And she was the chair at that time, and then eventually we worked back and forth, chair. She was chair, then I was chair, then she was chair. We switched off, and we had lots of fun with that group, and that group still is very active today. In fact, she was just at our meeting, and she planned some things that will be going on with our club. This group itself had, over the years, we've gotten supplies for Harbor House, disaster relief for hurricanes, worked at Community Clothes Closet. Marilyn had a hand in all of these things. She planned all this stuff, and we just did what she told us to do, which was great. including the projects we are working on now, which is saving paws. If you noticed out the back door, we have things for cats and dogs that we take care of. If ever I had a problem or a question about anything, I would call Marilyn. In fact, last week before I had my meeting, I was going to call her because I wanted to ask her something, and my heart just sank because I couldn't ask her. It was very difficult. Marilyn was an extraordinary person, smart, a little stubborn, faithful, dependable, and a great friend. We miss her already.
Is there someone out here who would like to say a word? Great. We'll get this turned on. And
I'm one of the newer members of the church, and one of the first people I met when I came the first time was Marilyn. She has a great sense of humor. During the time with Dorcas and everything else, we would have some sparring matches, but she had the knowledge that I didn't have. She was always forgiving. She had a quirky little smile that I loved, and she was a great friend, and I will miss her very much.
I know Marilyn through United Church Women. And I'm sure she was a member long before I was. But we went down to DeForest, Wisconsin for our state meetings. And one time I drove, and on the way home we were talking about how long it took us to get there. And she said, well, it only takes Beth 15 minutes. Obviously, I was driving a little too fast for her mom. I also heard many stories about her husband and fishing. Marilyn was great. I'll miss her.
I remember serving on the music committee with Marilyn. Found out very quickly she really did not care for the organ. We were talking about getting a grand piano. She was all for it. The bigger the better, because she loves her piano music, and she also loves listening to the choir, even though she couldn't sing much.
Anyone else, please?
Well, as you heard, Marilyn wasn't too fond of organ music, to put it mildly. I was the organist here a few years ago. Morgan, and at certain events like Church Women United, I'd play the piano. She just wanted it on piano, and we did find a way to make it work, and I think she even complimented me a few times. we got along. I was so grateful. My mother lived with us for 10 years, and there were several times during that time that Joe and Marilyn came, and they took my mother out to lunch, which gave me a much-needed break. And they would always take me to a place that served a little wine, because Mom told them, I'm allowed to have one glass of wine a day, my doctor said. And so it was real special. So I'm so grateful to know her and all she did, and she'll be missed.
Hi, my name is Lori, and Marilyn was my father, and my aunt. And she was supposed to be funny, but Terry, her daughter, always said, I am Marilyn's love child because I'm just like Marilyn. We still haven't figured out the father.
I've got a few ideas.
When I was a youth director, we used to have the greatest times at craft nights that probably weren't church appropriate, but we'd laugh until we cry or pee our pants. And Marilyn did have a way of getting things done. Marilyn used to complain about Harvey. When Harvey was here, if you knew Harvey, if your phone rang at 10:30 at night, our old pastor, you knew you were reading in church the next day. And Marilyn and him would always spat, but Marilyn was exactly the same way. She could talk anybody into doing anything at church. And I am going to so miss her yelling at me or screaming at me at things to get things done. She had a huge heart, and she just was bossy. And today, being at her funeral and not having her yell at me downstairs is going to be hard. And I'm going to miss all her knowledge. And she was always kind to everybody and made everyone feel equal and welcome at her church. She was an amazing woman.
Hi, my name's Chuck. I knew Marilyn. I've been at this church since I was baptized here. And I knew Marilyn as a Sunday school teacher, and all the years, but what sticks in my mind is every church has somebody who gets things done. And there's a country song that George Jones did, who's gonna fill their shoes? And these are gonna be some big shoes, hard shoes to fill. She was a wonderful lady.
I wanted to acknowledge that Marilyn is a mentor for many of us here at church. Those of us that you will see in the kitchen working downstairs have all been educated by Marilyn. We are well aware of the lists that are made, and we already forgot one today. So we apologize, Marilyn. I also wanted to acknowledge there are some ladies here this morning that you heard from Church Women United. Marilyn was a strong, strong advocate for Church Women United in the state and in the local unit. And she was awarded the Valiant Woman Award several years back by the Church Women United. She talked me into joining Church Women United, and now she left me alone at Church Women United and took off. So she was wonderful. She was a terror sometimes, but in the end, she always would grumble and complain, and she would sit, and then she'd sit down and say, "Oh, I'm such a bee." And then you know, but that's what made us all love her. She could tear into us, but then she could love us too, and we all loved her back.
This is great. Is there anyone else?
Hi, I'm not a member of the Emmanuel UCC, but I just wanted to say, because I guess I'm not the only one, there might be someone seated next to me that this is also true of, how generous Marilyn was with her children's friends. After I became friends with Tracy, she sort of took part in my attempts to take care of my parents, and as my family grew smaller and smaller, the support from the Rook Islands grew bigger and bigger, and that was because of Tracy, but also because of her mother, who gave that great example. And I think I'm not the only one of her children who appreciates that legacy that Marilyn passed on to her children.
When you're downstairs for lunch today, that's the time to say what you didn't say up here during worship. Okay, make sure you tell the story. As long as we keep telling the story, Marilyn lives on, and lives on forever. So keep telling the stories. If you think of a story, this is true. If you think of a story tomorrow, call Joe, call Tracy, call Terry. No, seriously. If you think of a story you want to share, that came to you just like that, call them and tell them. Do not let it stay in your own heart. You gotta share, because that's how eternal life works, and that's how the story keeps on, keeps on, keeps on. So again, when you're downstairs, make sure you do. Autumn.
Thank you.
Today when I went down in the basement to get a cup of coffee early on, I looked toward the stool that's down there in the kitchen. And I looked at it because I was seeing Marilyn there, because that's where she always was on days like today. The other day I got a text from Larry from the funeral home, and he said, "Who's the lunch lady? Who's the lunch lady?" And I texted back, "Marilyn." It's the truth, and we all know it. When I first came here nearly 5 years ago, it was dead of winter, snow outside. I come to church, and Marilyn says, "Where's your pants?" I said, "Marilyn, I don't feel comfortable wearing pants, you know, doing what I do." And she goes, "I wouldn't be worrying about it. You live in Wisconsin now." "Ah, Marilyn, I wear pants now." So it was about a month ago. We were nearing our 135th anniversary here at the church. I got a call. No, this was down in the fellowship hall. "Marilyn says, I just got to talk to you about this anniversary celebration." I said, "Hey, tell me, what do you think?" And she goes, "I have ideas, and you're not going to tell me no." And you laugh because you know it's the truth. Everything about her. It was beautiful today. The first song that Autumn sang for us, "Here I Am, Lord," is one that Marilyn said we absolutely, absolutely have to sing at our anniversary. It was one that was important to her. She loved the words. In fact, Marilyn lived that out. "Here I am, Lord." I think that could have been her motto in life, because then she took that on to be so much more. Have you forgotten already the scripture that I shared? Let me tell you again. "Which commandment is the first of all?" they asked Jesus, and he said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself." I'm telling you today, that's Marilyn. She embodied those words more than anybody I have known in a very, very long time. And the one thing that I adored about Marilyn, not that she was the one who almost single-handedly built this church and activities that were here, but what I loved about Marilyn is that she embodied the command to love, but she also told it like it was. You never had a doubt about where she stood on any issue. You never had a doubt whether she liked you or not. Let me tell you, you knew what she thought, where she stood, what it was all about, whether it was her kids, whether it was about Joe, Luna, or Aaron, whether it was something about the church, Harvey, Melinda, or anybody else who came before me, whether it was about politics, current ones or ones of old, whether it was about politicians, whether she had an idea about social issues going on, anything civic, anything local, national, or global. If you didn't know something and you wanted an opinion, Marilyn grew up here in Kakana, one of 10 children. This last year has been difficult for their family because she lost two of her brothers just in the last year. Her sister Hope is here today. It's a lot. But not only the 10 that grew up together, but then Joe, and the 10 that Joe's from, and then the rest, you know, the entire community is filled with people who know and who love Marilyn. A tender heart for so much. I can't tell you the countless conversations I had with her and her heart. She was involved in everything, or had an opinion about everything. Not only was she that way with her work at the mill and all those charitable events, but she was that way with activities. Terry or Tracy had a game, an activity, a something or other, she was there. Tracy said that one time she was playing softball and she broke your wrist, right? Yeah, and Marilyn hadn't gotten there yet to the game, and they're taking her to the get care for her brokenness, and Marilyn comes, it's just, that's the way she was. Anything for Aaron and Luna, she was always there. Marilyn was probably the helicopter mom. We didn't even know the term about, at least in showing up to everything, because she cared enough. Not only that, but Marilyn was involved in a lot of things as she grew up too, and you saw some of the pictures up here on the screen that are still going. She swam, she bowled, she did all kind of activities here, and even after having a family. So she and Joe met at the county fair at the harness racing. 55 years. Today's day and age, that is a miracle. 55 years together, two children, grandchildren, granddogs, all of this together. This is a miracle. And the beauty. So just one thing that I've told a couple people, and I still am laughing about it. When we met a little over a week ago, heard the story that you all took family vacations up to Crandon every year. You're going up there. And so in the car, in the station wagon, Marilyn would keep saying, are you girls awake back there? Are you awake back there? Only because the fuel that they needed for their vacation was in the car in the back. Perhaps the girls would get asphyxiated then. No sleeping for Terry or for Tracy. No, not at all. She loved to fish, hours out in the boat. She loved to eat. It seems like it's a while ago now, but one night we were out at Mark's East Side to have dinner. And sometimes I like to take pictures of the food and post them on Facebook because it's like, yeah, you know, other people are doing it, why not? So I posted a picture, Mark's East Side. Not 2 seconds later, I get a message from Terry saying, we're here too, where are you? Well, we're around in the back. Go back there, and there you all were, eating with Hope, having a great time. Marilyn loved to eat, and she loved that joy. When we had our 135th anniversary, we were talking about what the food might look like, what it might be. She goes, we're taking care of it. We're taking care of it. She was here that day. She was here that day, and then she was here the next Sunday, and I think that made it really important in her whole kind of lifespan, because not only was she here for the anniversary of her church, but then the next week when we had new members join and 5 young people be confirmed, I could just look at her sitting right over there and that smile on her face, the joy of that moment. And those are the things we hold on to. Got this message from Church Women United, and I just want to share some of the things that Marilyn was involved in. Because not only locally here in town, but you know, this is big, right? This is really big, and so many are here today. And the thing is, we just had a meeting a Friday ago of Church Women United here, and we prayed for her that morning. Hear this, in 2008, she was the Allegheny co-president, then the president from 2009 through 2014. 2012 through 2014, she was the finance chair of the whole state, Church Women United. In 2016, she was the treasurer and co-editor of the newsletter. 2019 to 2022, she was the finance co-chair or chair. All of this, someone who is so important and really cared about something bigger. She was always telling me about when the meetings were going to be and where they were, and that I could join via Zoom, even some of the latest ones. This is Marilyn. You saw a picture of her up there at some point, Marilyn receiving her Valiant Woman Award, which is on the easel right over here. Someone who had a heart, someone who really cared. All these things, and you could say she was a control freak, but you know, you need those in life. You need those in the way it is. Not only leadership in Church Women United, but leadership here, leadership in family, leadership in community. Have you forgotten the words from scripture I shared with you yet? What is it to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, and your neighbor as yourself? That's Marilyn, and that's the charge. and that's what you're about, but I just have one more thing to say. I would call Marilyn, but you couldn't call before like 1 o'clock. And if Joe answered, he'd say, well, let me see, right? Let me see. She's upstairs still or something. And we get on the phone. And you know, because she probably did it to you, but every time you hung up, she would say, love you. Love you. When Marilyn was in the hospital, and I knew she was there, I called. I called her every day in that hospital, as many of you did too. And we talked, and she would share. On Saturday when I called, she couldn't find the game. What channel? What channel? All they have on here are Mickey Mouse channels, she said. I said, BTN, Marilyn. BTN, Big Ten Network. I'm going to get on that. And then the next day, well, the Packers. But I called her after the Packers, and that was when they were in their losing streak. And we talked about that. She told me she had a little meltdown. She wanted to come home. She thought she was coming home, but she said, I'm all right now. It's okay, tomorrow. And tomorrow came. It came without her coming home. But the last word she said on every one of those phone calls to me and to all of you was, love you. I think that's the message today throughout all of this. The joy, the sorrow, the stories that you have that will never end. Everything about her exuded one word only, and that was love. Because she had it, and her heart was that big, and it meant so much. And although she's not in body with us, that love will never end. Surely it will never end. It was that big. Let's join our hearts. God, you are our strength and our redeemer. You are the giver of life and the conqueror of death. We praise you this day with humble hearts and with faith in your great mercy and wisdom, we entrust Marilyn to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for her all the days of her earthly life. We thank you for all that she was to those who loved her. This day we pray for Joe, Terry, Tracy, Aaron, Luna, all those family and friends who are gathered in this place. May your hand be upon them as they move from this day into the eternal life stage of Marilyn. May their hearts be made glad by all the memories. May their mourning turn into dancing. May joy come again. And for the meal that we will share, may our hearts also be filled with knowing that sharing a meal and talking one with another brings forth memories, brings forth so much. So may those who provided, who will serve those who helped this day, may that food be for us what we truly need for the journey that is ahead, for our church, for the whole that will be left because of her, we pray. Most of all, we pray that you would keep us all in communion with your faithful people of every time and place, that at last we may rejoice together in the heavenly family where Jesus Christ reigns with the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. As we pray together the prayer our Savior taught us, using whatever words are familiar to us, our Father.
Thank you.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Marilyn, a sheep of your own flock, a daughter of your own redeeming. Receive her into the hands of your mercy with all the saints in light. May you receive her with the same love that she gave to all. Amen. And for all of you who are left on this journey, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our closing hymn, and then we will make our way out to the courtyard. And again, if you would like to join us, please feel free. Our closing hymn, number 77.